بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين، وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين، وصحابته الغر الميامين، ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Definitely it's a different Ramadan. Ramadan with an experience that, up to my knowledge, it's unheard of. I haven't heard ever that people have fasted in Ramadan, locked up in their houses. They can't go to the masjid. They can't go to Taraweeh. They cannot go to Jum'ah. This is. I think it's a new experience for the whole Ummah of Islam. Yet that doesn't actually take away from our ajr, inshallah. Inshallah, our ajr will be even doubled because Allah is very generous, and Allah has permitted such a situation where COVID-19 fall over people and had them to behave in such a direction. However, Ramadan is always has its own things, and probably the best start for Ramadan is to try to extract the meaning and the purpose that why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has imposed Siyam upon this Ummah, just like he did upon previous nations. Like he said subhanahu wa ta'ala, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. The thing with the ibadat that includes siyam, that Allah sometimes gives you the hikmah, the reason, the wisdom that He has imposed and requested that type of ibadah, and sometimes He doesn't, and He leaves it to the ulama and the mufakkirin of Islam to come out with the wisdom, or maybe after the experience and find the perfect outcome of that specific ibadah. But this ibadah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it so straightforward from the very first ayah that I wanted to fast because I wanted to gain taqwa. It's so straightforward. So the illah, the reason that we fast because we want to gain taqwa. Now, taqwa is a big topic to talk about, but it's really important that we need a kind of definition. Everybody talk about taqwa. Most of the definition you hear from ulama, for me, most likely to be a description for taqwa, but not a definition for taqwa. So when you hear the ulama says, even from as-sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim, makhafatu al-jaleel wal-amalu bil-tanzeel wal-istidadu li-yawm al-rahil, this is from Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. This is how to imagine taqwa, how to practice taqwa. It's more of a description for taqwa. But why don't we go to the most taqi human being, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, وَأَنَا أَتْقَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ. No one can claim that he has even close taqwa to the taqwa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has described taqwa as in the hadith that he said, لَا يَبْلُغُ الْعَبْدُ أَنْ يَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ حتى يدع ما لا بأس به حذرا مما به بأس. So simple that to reach that level of taqwa, or to be one of the muttaqin. It's not like you're going to be an absolute taqwa, because it seems like people cannot get that level unless they're prophets. But to the worshipper, the abd, that individual slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, won't get to be among those who are described or classified as muttaqin unless he leaves a kind of a buffer zone, a wide buffer zone. The wider buffer zone is the more taqwa you have. حَتَّى يَدَعَ مَا لَا بَأْسَ فِيهِ. You give up what seems to be okay, what seems to be halal and permissible. خَشْيَةً and خَوْف, out of fear, of to be close to that zone where it's going to be a kind of Sharia issue or halal or haram issue. So you leave, you give up, tada, you give up what seems to be halal. What is halal? ما لا بأس فيه. There's nothing wrong with that. خشيته, because out of fear of to be too close to where the borders of Allah or the haram zone or the even makruh zone. So this is what taqwa. It means you have to be careful. Taqwa means be careful. Very simple. So people as Muslim, because we're Muslim, when we have fear of Allah, we build. We always try to build and create that buffer zone in our actions. So the wider the buffer zone is, the more taqwa people have. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu wa arda, when he became al-Khalifa, he has given ata, or like an annual salary or wages for those al-Muhajirin who left Mecca to Al-Madinah running away with the deen of Allah. Not running away, but they wanted to support the deen of Allah. So he decided, because he has lots of money now, he decided to give each one of them, each muhajir, 4,000 dinar, say dollar at that time. His son, Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhuma, was one from among the muhajirin. He assigned him only $3,500. Then he said, "Dad, father, why I am one of the muhajirin?" He said, "No, you have done the hijrah with your father. You're not the same with like those who have done the hijrah by themselves. You have some backup with your father, and that's different." So that is the buffer zone he was aware of. I mean, if you have given him the $4,000 or dinar at that time, he's fine. He's a muhajir. Technically, he is. But thinking of these details, that puts you within the taqwa zone and keeps you from the himallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the haram zone. So this is the best description for taqwa. When we try to imagine taqwa, create a perspective for taqwa, think of that buffer zone that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is expecting you to have just out of fear of Allah. So yes, I can do that, but you're not, let's recalculate. This is taqwa. So if siyam is all about gaining taqwa, so siyam, which falls once a year, sounds like an annual training course. Allah has designed that training course for this ummah, for the Muslimin, in order to ensure taqwa for them. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Allah had made it so straightforward. It's so unique, this training course for taqwa. It's so unique. You know why it's unique? Because it's designed in the heavens. في السماء. Allah has designed it, and Allah has detailed it, when to start, when to hold, not to eat, when to break, what to do during the day. And because it's a training course, you need to have the tools for those course. So the tools Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also taken care of. Yes, it is designed. So what are tools people need in order to practice or get into that course and study it well, practice it well, train themselves, their self very well? Allah has done all the precautions to ensure that siyam the outcome of siyam will lead to taqwa. And Allah also has put enough motivations for everyone. No one can say, well, I can say I don't have a motivation. There are more motivation than anyone can imagine. And that's so clear in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which has been narrated in a different, phrased differently sometimes, but the meaning is the same. One of them that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith sahih, of course, قال إذا كان أول ليلة من شهر رمضان صفدت الشياطين ومردت الجن وغلقت أبواب النار فلم يفتح منها باب وفتحت أبواب الجنة فلم يغلق منها باب وينادي مناد يا باغي الخير أقبل ويا باغي الشر أقصر ولله عتقاء من النار وذلك كل ليلة. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set all what we need for that specific or for this specific taqwa course. First, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tightened, he locked up all the shayateen. Now the thing with the human being that when we do the bad action, there are two factors. One, it's inner factor, and one's outer factor. The inner factor is yourself, is your desires, your raghabat, your shahawat. You're driven naturally by your instincts and your desire to do something. And sometimes, you know, you do things because you cannot reach out with halal, or you think that's the only chance to do it with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it's haram. So yourself is nagging inside, but the other support, which is from outside, that's the whisper of shaitan. So the whisper of shaitan is an outside factor, and that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken care of. Allah has taken care of. So the whisper of shaitan is not there anymore in Ramadan. So that's the first precaution, that the whisper of shaitan is not there anymore. Because shaitan comes to you, he won't hold your hand and stretch it, extend it to the haram. No, but he will whisper to you and encourage you and try to wire your brain to make this halal okay, or this haram okay. وَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ وَأَعْمَالُهُمْ الشَّيْطَانُ come and decorate and make it sound and looks good to you and looks okay to do that haram or to attend that haram, but he won't force you. Even with that level of whispering, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blocked it, and there's no outside factor, there's no outside impact for the person to attempt haram. Or could be makruh, could be anything that doesn't please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, for us, this is where the taqwa effect starts to actually work, when you monitor yourself. That's the only way that you monitor yourself. Now, if you feel now you're actually desiring to do something and you know it is haram, it is makruh, or it's something won't please Allah, this is where you look inside yourself and say, wait, there's no shaitan, so it's all about me now. I want to put now front of my eyes all these bad desires, all these bad thoughts, all these bad heart diseases. Just like people have arrogance sometimes. People look in your heart. Do I really love to show off a lot? I do everything because I want to be complimented and people point out to me with their fingers. No, is this what I want? Okay, is it about showing off and riya? Wait a minute, is it about I want to be so competitive in a way that no one should be better than me? Do I have hasad? Look at inside the heart and see now it's not the shaitan, it's me. So I figure out all my problems and work on them, and that is the taqwa. So when you eliminate all the bad thoughts, bad desires, I call it heart diseases, I am wired that I don't want anyone to be smarter than me. I am so wired that I don't want anyone to stand out more than me. I am so much wired that I feel I'm the best among all of these guys. I am arrogant. You have to eliminate all these diseases and replace it with humbleness, replace it with generosity, replace it, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. Replace it with all these good, great meanings and good ethics, and then you automatically find yourself getting taqwa. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken care of that and put the shayateen, وَمَّرَدَ الشَّيَاطِينَ, even the strong ones and the weak ones, lock them up for the whole month. And Allah also subhanahu wa ta'ala has closed the gates of Jahannam. It sounds like I don't want anyone to go to Jahannam. The gates of Jahannam, the doors of Jahannam, they're locked. They're like shut down now. They're shut down. There's nothing goes to that direction. it gives you that great feeling that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not waiting for me to make mistake to take me to Jahannam. No, Allah wants me, on the contrary, to go to Jannah. The doors, the gates of Jannah are all opened and waiting for me, for even little good action, Allah will multiplicate it in order to make you qualify for Jannah. Allah is so generous, and Allah shakur, Allah appreciative. Allah appreciates little, even shiqqu tamra, and He will multiply it. Allah will take your little good action and good deed, and Allah will make it bigger, will multiplicate it in order for you to go to Jannah. So that's a big motivation too. Now we said that the shaitan will be locked, but instead of that, there is an angel, there is malak, every single day will stand outside and he will cry, Ya Baghi al Khair Aqbil, those who are looking for good things, those who are actually willing to do and get the good things, we want you to come in, come in. You're gonna feel it. If you have that intention inside, Allah will make you feel it, and that will help you. And those who actually baghi al-shar, he's not gonna hear anything. He's gonna be also demotivated to do anything good. And alhamdulillah, because we're Muslimin, we have that pure fitrah that Allah makes you always connected. Anything happens, it doesn't happen for no reason. Whatever Allah sent that angel to make that statement in the morning, you should have your share of it. And that's a spiritual motivation for you also to go and be the successful person out of that taqwa course. And of course, لِلَّهِ عُتَقَى مِنَ النَّارِ ذَلِكَ كُلُّ لَيْلَةٍ. Allah will liberate. Allah will send people free from nar every single night. Every night there are certain number of people will be liberated from nar. If Allah decided that this person is not going to nar, that he's never going to nar. He's never going to Jahannam. So this course that has been designed for Muslimin in order to help them to gain taqwa end of the month has been designed perfectly, and all the precautions for you to succeed in that course has been taken, and all the motivation has been put out. So my point, brothers and sisters, that when it comes to that point, we need to monitor ourselves. And here we go back to the ultimate goal is to gain taqwa. If we know that we have those weaknesses and we monitor them and work on them, even if you pass 50%, you are better than first of Ramadan. You should come out of the 30th day of Ramadan better than the first day of Ramadan. It is a problem if you don't. Even if you do it 10% better, that will be amazing. The other thing about taqwa, it's that will put you, if you gain, the more taqwa you gain, the more connection you have with the Quran. You know why? Because in the second page of Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif lam mim, dhalika al-kitabu la rayba fih. Al-Quran, there's no doubt, there's no mistakes, there's nothing, there's no ups and downs, always on the top. Quran, there's no ups and downs in Quran. La rayba fih. There's no nothing wrong in it. And it is what? Hudan. It's a guidance for lil muttaqeen. So the more taqwa you have automatically, and that's like a law, it will work by default, the more hidayah, the more guidance you get from the Quran. You read the Quran in the very first day of Ramadan, you will get hidayah. But you definitely should gain more from the Quran when you read it at the last day of Ramadan. Why? Because your taqwa has escalated like that. So the amount of hidayah will come with it. Why? This is the law of Allah. How does it work? We don't know. It's the job of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you gain that hidayah from the Quran. Subhanallah, it's the Quran falls in the hearts. and the cleaner the hearts are, the more it reacted to the Quran, and then it will manifested, will be manifested on the actions and in the speeches. Subhanallah, people light up after Ramadan more than before Ramadan. Why? Because this is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the unique thing also about the Siyam, and that's something just why we pondered about Siyam, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, kullu, in the Hadith Qudusi, of course, kullu amal ibn Adama lahu illa as-sawm. Every type of action that son of Adam does, that's his. Except Siyam, it's mine. And I'm the one who knows how to reward it. I'm the one who's going to give the reward for Siyam. Why? Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's mine, Siyam, it's Allah's. I cannot think of any king or leader or dictator in the history that asked, who asked people to stop eating and practice fasting out of glorifying for himself. No one can ask for that. Siyam has no ritual to show. Now, people, when you pray, it's a ritual. Your body moves, you show something. When you give donation, it's a ritual. When you go to Hajj, there's a rituals. There are rituals for it. Every act of worship is ritual. And these rituals, by the way, can be applied for human. People in the past, they prostrated for their kings. Even in the era of Sayyidina Yusuf, alayhi salam, وَخَرُّوا لَهُ سُجَّدًا. That happened. And probably it was permissive at that time. The Jababira, the kings and those were in power, they asked people to cry out with their names, just like you see Allahu Akbar. So every act of worship, people have practiced it for other people or maybe for other objects, like someone who makes sujood for Sanam, for example. But no one ever can claim that I have my nation, they're fasting for my sake. No one can ever ask for that, or he can guarantee that. So it's only for the sake of Allah. So this type of ibadah can be only practiced for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because even if someone asks you, you can fake it. You can fake tiredness. You can fake being thirsty. You can fake being hungry. You can fake it, but who knows actually that you are really fasting? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is a very deep meaning, that if you really can do that for the sake of Allah, in your necessities, out of fear of Allah, you can be by yourself and you're in August and it's so hot in Saudi Arabia and you have that glass of water right in front of you, you won't touch it. Why? Allah is looking at me. If you can do that, and we come back to taqwa, with the necessities, you'd actually rather do it with the desires. There are needs and desires. If you can control yourself with something that separates you from, maybe if you want to think about it, like from life and death, I would rather control myself with something that just an illusional pleasure sometimes, or something that I can live without. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it so clear that he want to see taqwa end of the month. So for us, inshallah, and this is a advice for myself too, brothers and sisters, that we want to fast with the intention that we want to graduate as muttaqeen. We want to have a certificate for taqwa, inshallah. Allah will give it to us. No one can come to you and say, oh, now, mashallah, you look like taqi to me. That's the magnificent thing about Islam. It's for Allah. إِلَّا الصَّوْمِ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْدِبِهِ. The certificates will be printed and hanged up there. No one's going to give you a certificate to put it on your wall in the office and say, this guy has been graduated as taqi. It's not going to happen like that. So it's for Allah. And that's the uniqueness, is the ikhlas, is the unique relationship with our Lord. So نسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يعيننا على الصيام والقيام وغض البصر وحفظ اللسان وأن يتقبل منا. سبحان الله يعيننا ليتقبل منا. نسأله ذلك ونسأله العون في كل أمورنا، ونسأل الله أن يرفع البلاء عنها عن الإنسانية بكل ما فيها، وأن يبدلنا بأيام خير من الأيام التي مرت. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم، وبارك الله فيكم على حسن استماعكم.